What you mean by exactly a semi-solid dosage forms? The semi-solid dosage forms are the dosage form in which it contains ointments, creams, paste as well as the gels. These dosage forms are applied topically. In this seminar today, we'll see regarding your how to the prepare your semi-solid dosage forms. Then what are the storage conditions, what are the ingredients we are using, what are the types of semi-solid dosage forms. In the basic introduction of your semi-solid dosage forms, semi-solid dosage forms can be defined as these are the pharmaceutical preparations which comprise a body of product which when applied to the skin or any kind of accessible mucous membranes which tends to alleviate or treat a pathological condition or other protection against the harmful environment. So in the semi-solid dosage forms, there are number of examples like ointment, paste, creams, gels, jelly. They are primarily applied on the skin. That's why they are called as the topical dosage forms also. Now, what should be a ideal property of your ointment or your cream or your gel? Generally, when any customer is thinking about any kind of dosage forms, so he will expect number of good properties from your semi-solid dosage form. So the first thing about your semi-solid dosage form, about the ideal properties is that regarding its physical properties. As per the physical properties, whatever the semi-solid dosage form is there, so it should have smooth structure. Smooth structure means it should have the very smoothness while applying on the, your skin. It should not cause any kind of irritation or it should not cause any kind of the smooth texture should provide by the, your ointment. Then there should be a elegant in the appearance. Most of semi-solid dosage form nowadays are having the very elegant look, but previously most of ointments we are using for the application, creams and gels were not preferred or they were not developed. So that's why previous dosage form like ointments are not having the elegant look, but today they have changed. So that's why in the ideal properties of ointment or the semi-solid dosage forms, it is assumed or it is considered that it should have the elegant appearance. It means attractive look. Another one is that it should be a non-dehydrating substance. Whatever the semi-solid dosage forms you are applying on your skin, so it should not dry your skin. Then another point is that it should be a non-gritty in nature. So there should not be grittiness in your ointment. So it should not scratch your skin when you are applying. Then another point is that it should not be a greasy and non-staining to your skin. Greasy means like your grease is there. When you are applying your ointment, so it should not make any kind of stain on your skin permanently. It should be easily washed out and it should not stick to your clothes also. Then another point is that it should be a non-hygroscopic in nature. Non-hygroscopic means when any substance is hygroscopic in nature, then it can absorb the moisture from the environment. And after application, it can cause the development of the microbes under the your skin or where it is applied. So that applied film may absorb the moisture and it may fall down from your applied skin or it may cause the development of microorganism. That's why it is recommended that whatever the ointments you are using, they should not be having the hygroscopic nature. Then another properties are like physiological properties. In the physiological properties, they are related to the, your sensitive properties or the sensation toward your body. The first property is the that your ointment should not be a irritating one. When you are applying your ointment or the cream or the gel, it should not cause any kind of irritation to your skin after the application. Then another point is that it should not alter the membrane function. Membrane function means your skin function. When you are applying any kind of semi-solid preparation on the your skin, so it should work as it is given or as it is contained any drug, but it should not give the any kind of side effect, or it should not change any anatomy or physiology of your skin. Then another point is that it should be miscible with the skin secretions, because when you are applying your ointment, so it may block the your pores. So when it is blocking the pores, so after the your sweat is secreting, so it should be come out from your skin pores. It should not block it, as well as when it is having the miscibility with the your sweat, it can easily pass inside your skin also. So that's why you will get the easily effect of that ointment or the cream or that gel. So these are the desirable properties or expected properties from your semi-solid dosage pumps. Physiological properties as well as the physical properties. Physical properties are related to your formula or the your ingredients present in your ointment or the your cream, and physiological properties are related to your active ingredient or physicochemical properties of that drug which is present and the base which is utilized for the semi-solid dosage form. Then another is the application properties. When we are applying your semi-solid dosage form, so it is expected that it should be easily applicable on your skin, it should be easily spread on your skin, and there should be a efficient drug release from your preparation inside your skin. Then only you will get the easily effect of that preparation. Then another point of semi-solid dosage pump is that it should have the high aqueous washability. It means when we have applied your preparation on your skin, so after some period it should be washed out easily with your normal water. So it will be easy to the customer or your consumer that after its work, so he can remove it easily, or there should not be any stickiness to your ointment. So these are the application related properties of your ointment. So these are the three types of major properties, like physical properties, physiological properties, and application properties of your semi-solid dosage form. Now, what are the possible advantages of your semi-solid preparation? As we suppose compare with your solid dosage form, liquid dosage forms. So compared to these both the dosage forms, what are the specific types of advantages for your semi-solid dosage forms? So the first advantage of semi-solid dosage form is that it is avoiding first pass effect of your drug, or it is avoiding the first pass metabolism of your drug. Because when we are applying your semi-solid dosage form on your skin, so it is reaching directly through your skin into the bloodstream. It means your drug, when it is present in the semi-solid dosage form and applied on your skin, it will transmit from your skin into the blood. So here the metabolism of your drug, which is generally occur into the stomach or the intestine, it has been avoided. Generally in case of oral dosage form, when you are taking any kind of dosage form through the oral cavity, like tablet, capsule, suspension, solution, so when they are reaches to the stomach, the enzymes contained inside your stomach will make metabolism of your drug. When the metabolism is occurs, the 50% or the most of the drug is get metabolized, and when the drug is getting metabolized, then that drug will not be able to show the its pharmacological action, because after the metabolism the structure of drug will get changed. Only the unchanged drug or the unmetabolized drug will be available for the showing action inside your body. So in simple way we can say through the your oral cavity, we can say that there is the wastage of drug will be occurred because of the metabolism process inside your stomach. But in case of semi-solid dosage pumps, we are applying them on the topical or the on the skin. That's why no need to go through the any kind of metabolism process, and it is directly reaches to the blood. That's why most of amount of drug is available for the your pharmacological action. Another advantage of semi-solid dosage pump is that they are very much convenient and easy to apply compared to the your injections, tablets, and semi-solid dosage pumps. There are so many problems regarding the administration of dose, because most of people are avoiding the tablet because of the swallowing problem. Childs cannot take the tablets because of the swallowing problem. Most of drugs are having the bitter in taste. So while taking the through oral cavity, they may feel the bitterness of that drug. So that's why compared to that type of dosage pumps, semi-solids are can be easily applied on your skin. So that's why there is no that much type of, we can say, problems regarding the application or the administration of the dose. Then in case of compared to the injections also, we can say injections are painful, but ointments are can be easily applied. No need of any kind of physician or any kind of specific person is required while application. So easily patient can apply that ointment on their own skin. Then another thing is that another advantage of semi-solid dosage pump is that we can avoid possible risk and inconveniences of the intravenous therapy as well as the varied conditions like absorption, pH changes, presence of enzymes, gastric emptying time. So compared to the your oral dosage pumps, we can say that your drug is not having any kind of metabolism. Suppose any person or any patient has taken large dose in oral dosage form. Suppose any person have taken the 2 or 3 tablets by mistakenly, then in that case toxicity may be occurred. Sometimes some drugs are not having the stability in the stomach pH, because your stomach is having the acidic pH. Most of drugs are getting deteriorated in the stomach acidic pH, as well as most of enzymes are there. They are attacking on the, your drug. They may react with your drug. So such kind of problems are not exist in the topical dosage pumps, or such kind of problems are not associated with the, your semi-solid dosage pumps, because your dosage pump is applied on the top or the on the skin. So it is not exposing to the higher acidic pH of your gastric fluid. There is no any kind of enzymes. So there is no so toxicity. Suppose by chance or by mistakenly you have applied a large amount of ointment or the any kind of gel on your skin, and suppose you are getting irritation, or you are thinking that there is might be a toxicity because you have applied the long large quantity of ointment, then immediately you can wash out it. So that's why we can avoid the such kind of toxicity also. Then another advantage of semi-solid dosage pump is that there is the achievement of efficacy with the lower total daily doses of the drug by the continuous drug input. Sometimes when we are applying your preparation on the, your skin, so we can enlarge the area also for getting the more effect, as well as we can apply it directly on the, your affected part where is the inflammation is occurred. So that's why there is the good efficacy we can achieve in case of the effect. Then we can avoid the fluctuation in the drug level also, because in case of the, suppose we have taken the large dose or the minimum dose in case of your oral dosage forms, then there might be a fluctuation in the drug level. So fluctuation of the drug level in the your body may be occurred because of the metabolism of the drug inside the stomach, because of the less absorption of the drug through the stomach, or in case of suppose injectable, if you will think, suppose we have injected the large dose, then also toxicity may be appeared, or the level of the drug may be, we can say, disturbed. But in case of topical dosage form, suppose you are, it is in your hand that how much amount you have, you want to apply. If you are not getting the effect, again you can apply the ointment. Suppose you are thinking that large dose is applied, then you can wash out it. So like this, there are the so many advantages, and we can avoid the fluctuation levels of the drug inside your body. Then another advantage of your ointment is that there is the ability to easily terminate the medications when it is required. Suppose you are thinking that you don't need or you do not have the need of that medicament again. Suppose any painkiller ointment is there and you have applied and you think that your pain is recovered, then you can wash out your ointment. It means we can terminate or we can stop the action of your drug when it is applied on the your skin or in the form of semi-solid dosage form. But suppose you have taken the tablet and you want to remove that tablet, so you cannot withdraw that dose. Suppose you have injected any injection in the form of liquid, intramuscular injection or intravenous injection, and after the injecting or administration of the dosage form, after a particular time, if you want to remove that dose, then it is not possible. So in this case, semi-solid dosage form when applied, then you can remove it also very easily. So it is called as the termination of your medication. Then there is the relatively large area for the application of your dose compared to the your buccal cavity, nasal cavity, or the stomach. So it is depend on the your wish that how much amount of area you want to apply. So you can take the whole part of your body also for the application of the semi-solids. Then another advantage of semi-solid is that they are having the ability to deliver the drug more selectively to the specific site. It means local action. It means suppose you are having the inflammation at the hand, so you can apply it on your particular affected area. So it is, we can say there is the delivery of the drug at the selective part or the at the specific site. Then another advantage of your semi-solid is that there is the minimum or there is the totally avoidance of the gastrointestinal incompatibility. So in the incompatibility chapter, we have seen that there are the number of incompatibility may be possible when your drug reaches to the stomach. So your drug may react with your intestinal fluid, intestinal content, acid. So because of that, incompatibility may be possible. But in this case, your drug is on your skin. It is not having the any kind of exposure with your acid, so or the any food content. That's why we can say there is the complete avoidance of gastrointestinal incompatibility of your drug. Then another advantage is that it is providing the utilization of the drug with short biological half-life and narrow therapeutic window. Now, what is mean by the biological half-life? First thing is that when any drug is there, so every drug is having the particular period that is called as the its biological half-life. So after particular half-life, like suppose any drug is having the 1 hour half-life. So after the administration of the drug, within that half-life period, that drug will be diminished from your body. Or after the particular period, suppose any drug is having the 1 hour half-life, suppose you have administered that drug inside your stomach. So after 1 hour, that drug will not be utilized because within that particular half-life period, it will be active. And after that period, it will be inactive. So in this, your semi-solid dosage form, we can utilize such kind of drugs whose half-life is very much short. So that kind of drugs, when we are applying on the particularly affected area, then you can get its maximum utilization. Suppose the same drug we are taking through the oral cavity, like in the form of your liquid dosage form or in the form of solid dosage form, then it has to take the too much time. First of all, they will go to your stomach. Then after that, your drug will be solubilized. Then it will be absorbed. And then it will reach to your affected area where it is required. So it is taking too much time. Suppose any drug is having a very lesser half-life, then such kind of drug may not be useful in this case. So suppose we are taking the advantage of such drug in the form of semi-solid dosage form, then in the form of semi-solid dosage form, suppose we are applying that drug, then directly they can reach into their bloodstream very fastly from your skin. So that's why there will be the minimum time will be there to their drug. And within that period or within its half-life, it will be available at the site of action. Then another is the, we can have the improving into the physiological and pharmacological responses of the drug. So when we are applying your semi-solid dosage pumps on the affected part, then we are having the increased physiological as well as pharmacological responses of that drug. You will get the maximum response of the drug because you are directly applying it on the affected area. Then another advantage of semi-solid dosage pump is that it improves the patient compliance. Now, what is mean by the patient compliance? Patient compliance means what? When we are taking any kind of therapy, so there should not be any kind of inconveniency to that patient. Suppose injectables are there. If you are taking the injection, then it is feeling the painful. If you are taking the tablet, then it will produce the bitterness into your mouth. So such kind of incompliances are not in case of your semi-solids, because when they are applied on your skin, they will not give any kind of such kind of bitterness, any kind of irritation, any kind of pain to that patient. So in this way, we can say there is the maximum patient compliance in the semi-solid dosage forms. Then it provides the suitability to the self-medication. Now, if you are thinking about the application of semi-solids, then it can be easily applied by that patient at any part of your body. Compared to the injectables, they are very suitable one. If you will think about the self-medication about your injections or the injectables, then it is quite difficult to take the self-medication or to take the self-injections, because it required the skilled persons. You need any physician, you need any kind of nurse or any compounder for the administration of the injectable. But compared to the injectable, your semi-solids are very easy to apply on your body. So by this way, we can say self-medication is possible with the help of your ointments or the gels or the creams. Now, what are the disadvantages of the semi-solid preparations? Now we have seen the advantages of your semi-solid. Now we'll see about the what are the particular type of limitations for the your semi-solid. Now semi-solid preparation also having the some disadvantages. First disadvantage is that there might be chances that skin irritation may be possible for the particular type of ointment, cream or the gel when they are applied. So it is depending on the suitability of that patient. Some people may have the suitability toward the oils, toward the ointments, toward the gels. So depending on the suitability, then dermatitis may be possible in case of the your semi-solid dosage pumps. Suppose you are applying continuously your preparation, so after a particular day, it might be possible that dermatitis may be caused because of the presence of some excipients. So it is not sure that every time you will get the dermatitis, but it is may be possible that dermatitis or irritation may be takes place. Then another disadvantage is that there is the poor permeability of the drugs through the skin in the particular conditions. So some drugs may not absorb through your skin, or all the drugs may not have the good absorption from your skin. So when some drugs we are administering in the form of semi-solid, so they may not be absorbed fully, or very small amount of the drug may be absorbed through your skin. So such kind of drugs we should not apply in the form of semi-solid dosage forms, or we should not deliver them in the semi-solid dosage form, because that drug itself not having the good permeability through your skin. So that drug will remain on your skin. It will not reaches to your bloodstream. Then you will not get the good effect. Then another thing, a disadvantage is that there is the possibility of allergic reactions. So many people are having the allergic reaction for the particular type of ointment, particular type of creams, as well as particular types of gels. So it is not for all the patient, but some particular patient may have the allergic reactions. Then another disadvantage is that we cannot be use semi-solid dosage form for the drugs which require the very small plasma concentration for the action. So some drugs, suppose that drug requires the large dose, Okay. Suppose any drug requires the large dose in case of the action, or any drug is having the large dose like 800 mg, 700 mg. So such kind of drugs we cannot give through the semi-solid dosage forms, because suppose you want to prepare the semi-solid preparation of that drugs, then we have to apply the large amount of ointment or the cream on the your surface of the skin. So that's why those drugs which are required the very small dose, that kind of drugs are only suitable in the form of semi-solid dosage forms. Then sometimes enzymes present in the epidermis may interact with your drug. Another disadvantage is that suppose you are having the solid form of the drug and you want to incorporate into the any kind of semi-solid dosage forms, so we have to decrease the particle size of that drug. Otherwise, we cannot apply or we cannot administer that type of drug into the semi-solid dosage forms. If the drug is having the larger particle size, then while application, it may scratch your skin and it may require too much time to dissolve and to pass into your bloodstream through the skin. Now, what are the types of your semi-solid dosage forms? There are the ointments, creams, jelly, paste are the types of your semi-solid dosage forms. Now, we'll see regarding the ointments. Now, what are the ointments? Ointments are homogeneous, translucent, viscous, semi-solid preparation, which are applied externally on the your skin or the mucous membrane. What are the ointments? Ointments are the homogeneous type of translucent, viscous, semi-solid preparations, which are intended for the external application to the your skin or the mucous membrane. Ointments are the two types, medicated ointments and non-medicated ointments. When we are not using the drug, then they are called as the non-medicated ointment. And when we are incorporating the drug, then they are called as the medicated type of ointment. There are the various uses of your ointments. First use of ointment is that they are used as emollient. Emollient means they are making the or they are imparting the smoothness to your skin. So there are so many we can say preparations are available, especially for the winter season purpose, like your petroleum jelly is there. So they are non-medicated ointments. They do not have any kind of particular drug. But when we are applying them, they are imparting the smoothness effect to your skin, or the your skin is become the smooth. Then another use of ointment is that application for the active ingredient to the skin. So along with the ointment, suppose we are adding any active ingredient, then it will be act as the medicated ointment. Then suppose anti-inflammatory drug you have added, then we can apply that ointment on the skin to avoid the inflammation of your skin or the affected area. Also, your ointment are used as occlusive. Now, occlusive means what? When we are applying your ointment on your skin, they are developing the very small thin layer or the film on your skin. So by this way, they are giving the protection to your skin from the environment. Because after the application of your ointment, so when we are spread it onto your skin, so they develop the skin, and because of that development of the small film, so the environmental conditions may not interfere with your skin. So simply we can say they are giving the protection to your skin. So they are called as the occlusive type of films. Then what are the ointment bases? Generally, for the preparation of ointment, we have to take the some excipients, or the we can say carrier, or in another language we can say as a your vehicles. So in the your semi-solid preparations, we have to take the bases as a vehicle. So they are nothing but the greasy materials, like waxy materials or the oily materials are there. So they are generally semi-solid in nature. So they are called as the ointment bases. So these ointment bases, we have to take and add the your medicament, and we have to mix it thoroughly. Then you will get the your medicated ointment or the cream. So generally, for the preparation of your ointment, we are using the various kind of waxy material. They are called as the bases. So there are the four type of bases we are using for the preparation of the ointment. The first base is called as the oleaginous base. Another base is called as the absorption base. Then another base is the water removable base, and last one is called as the water soluble base. So generally these four types of bases we are using for the preparation of your ointments, and these four bases are their own characteristics, that's why they have different names. Generally ointments are prepared by the fusion method or the just mixing method. Then after the preparation of ointments, we have to test them for the various kind of properties like microbial contamination, then minimum fill of that container, then packaging and storage, as well as labeling we have to check, and some additional standards we have to check. Now what are the creams? Creams are also semi-solid preparation, but basically creams are emulsion in nature, or the it is the mixture of oil plus water. So they are viscous semi-solid emulsion with opaque appearance, as contrasted with the translucent ointments. So they are looking like ointments, but they are having the typical properties, like they are having the mixture of oil plus water, and they are having the opaque look, and they are little bit attractive than the your ointments. As well as the your creams are having the two types, like OW creams as well as the WO creams. WO cream means water in oil cream, and OW cream means oil in water cream. So they are basically emulsion, and emulsion are having the two types, water in oil emulsion and oil in water emulsion. So what are the specifications of that both the creams, like OW cream and WO cream? When we are thinking about the WO cream, then in the WO cream, that is water in oil. So in the water in oil cream, it contain the lipophilic emulsifying agent. And in case of oil in water cream, it contains the OW type of emulsifying agent. Then your water in oil creams are generally used as emollient as well as the as a cleansing agent. Your water in oil cream is used as emollient because it is having the maximum portion of oil, so it will give the emollient effect on your skin. But in case of oil in water cream, they are used as a elegant drug delivery system. So generally they are applied for the as a medicated cream. Then another semi-solid dosage form is the paste. So your routine oral paste is there, which is you are using for the cleaning of your tooth. But apart from that, some other paste are also there. So these paste are nothing but the your semi-solid preparations, and they are generally used for the application on your skin for the treatment purpose, as well as for the giving the protection to your skin purpose. So these are the different kind of paste, okay, than the your oral cleaning paste or the toothpaste. So these paste are generally containing the some ingredients like giving the protection to your skin from the sunburning. So they are applied in the form of very thin film on your skin to give the protection to your skin. And generally it contains the water insoluble materials. Okay. So when we want to remove that paste, so easily it can be removed by using the your normal washings. It contains the high percentage of insoluble solids, near about 50% insoluble solids and 50% aqueous material. We have to mix and we have to make the thick material, or the we can say semi-solid material. Then these pastes are usually prepared by incorporating the solid material directly and mixed with the help of your mortar and pestle. Generally while mixing your paste, we are mixing with the help of any kind of stirrer or the pestle. So continuously, vigorously, we have to mix all the ingredient. That method is called as the levigation. Then this kind of paste are having the adhesive agents. Adhesive agent means like gums are there. So when we are mixing the such kind of adhesive gums, so that paste will stick to your skin perfectly for the longer period. These paste are not having the any kind of greasiness when they are applied on your skin. Just for the protection purpose, we are applying this paste. So after the normal washing, we can remove it very easily. Then gels are there. Now gels and jellies are also one part of your semi-solid preparations. Nowadays they are very much popular than your creams, than your ointments, because they are having the very much attractive look. So that's why gels are preferred by the consumers, and they are little bit easy for the manufacturing compared to your ointments as well as the creams. So the gels are semi-solid system in which liquid phase is constrained with a 3D polymeric matrix having a high degree of physical as well as the chemical cross-linking. Basically, the gels as well as the jellies, when they are prepared, the base of the gels and jellies is, we can say, modified gel base. Generally, they are prepared in such a manner that when we are giving the stirring effect or we are giving the pressure, so they will get liquefy, and as we are removing the stress, they are becoming the solidify or they are becoming the viscous. So because of that, these gels are preferred. While applying your gels on your skin, you are generally used to rub. Because of that rubbing action, they will get liquefy and they will easily spread. And as soon as you are stop the rubbing, then they will try to solidify and they will stable on your skin. So that's why the structure is called as the 3D like polymeric matrix type of structure. Gels are aqueous colloidal system of hydrated form of insoluble medicaments. So insoluble medicaments are there. Generally that medicaments or that solid material like alginic acid is there. So they are having the tendency to absorb the maximum amount of water. Like your gum is there. If you are adding the water into your gum, then they will try to absorb the maximum amount of your water and they will try to get swell. And after some period, if you are exposing it to the temperature, then it will lose its water and again they can become the solid material. So generally such a material we are using for the preparation of the gels, which material are having the tendency to absorb the maximum amount of water and to get swell. Jellies are the transparent and translucent non-greasy type of semi-solid preparation, and it contains water soluble gels or the more water than the gels. So they are little bit liquidic in nature than your gels. Gels are too much viscosity. Jellies are having the less viscosity. Generally jellies as well as gels are used for the medication purpose, lubrication purpose. Then for they are acting as a carrier for the drug. It means we can make medicated gel and medicated jellies also. These are the types of gel phases. Actually, they are, you can say, structured type of bases are there. So single phase and two phase system generally we are using for the preparation of the gel base. Generally, we have to use the particular type of excipients to prepare the gel base. In case of single phase gel, we are using the macromolecules, which are uniformly distributed throughout the liquid with no apparent boundaries between the disappeared macromolecules. And in case of two-phase system, we are using the mask consist flocculated type of material. Now the composition of your gel. When we are thinking about the gel, generally it consists of gelling agent or the material which can convert your material into the gel. That's why it is called as the gelling agent. Then we require the water. Then we require the co-solvents if it is required. Then we have to add the preservatives to prepare to preserve or to protect your gel from the microorganisms, as well as we have to add the stabilizers. Stabilizers means like antioxidant agents also is there to make your gel more stable. So these are the particular type of ingredients we have to add into the your gel. Then kinds of gel or the types of gel. Nowadays there are the different types of gels are available. Like first one is the hydrogel. Hydrogel means that gel is having the maximum capacity to absorb the water, and when it is applied, it will liberate that water and it will stick to your skin. So in this way, there is the silica, bentonite, pectin, sodium alginate, methyl cellulose, and alumina. So these kind of agents or the ingredients are nowadays available. Suppose we have prepared the gel by using these ingredients, then that gel will be called as a hydrogel. Then organic gels are there. Generally, in the organic gels, it contains the an organic liquid like plastic base. So these are the different types of material we have to use to prepare the organic gel or its base. Then carbomer gels are there. They are prepared by using the carbomers or the derivatives of the carbomers. Then methyl cellulose gel is there, which is used prepared by using the methyl cellulose material. Then starch glyceride gels are there, which are prepared by using the starch. Then aluminium hydroxide gel is there, which is utilized by prepared by using the aluminium hydroxide. Now the formulation of your semi solid preparation. Generally, in the formula of your semi solid preparation, it contains the active ingredients. If it is required, if you want to make the medicated type of semi solid preparation, then you have to take the any kind of drug that is called as the active material. Then rest of materials are like base, which is most important one. Then preservative to preserve your preparation. Then humectants are the ingredients which are required in your preparation to maintain the required quantity of moisture. Then antioxidants are added. Antioxidants will avoid the oxidation of your product. Then emulsifying agents are there. In case of creams, we have to add the emulsifiers if it is prepared. So emulsifier will stabilize your cream, otherwise your cream will be breakdown. Emulsifier is nothing but the emulsifying agent or the surface acting agent. Then gelling agent is required in case of gel. If you want to prepare the gel, then you have to add the gelling agent. Then buffers are added. Buffers are the those agents which can maintain the required pH in the your formulation throughout the life of that product. So if you are adding the such a drug which is having the pH dependent solubility, then you have to add the buffering agent to maintain the required pH of your product. Now bases are the main part of your semi solid preparations, and depending on that basis only we can prepare the semi solid preparations. So it is the one of the most important ingredient used in the formulation of the semi solid dosage forms. Now what should be the ideal properties of your bases? Generally, this bases we are using for the your ointments also, for the suppositories also, as well as for the your gel also. So the ideal properties of bases are like that. First thing is that they should compatible with the skin, they should compatible with the pH of your drug. It means when you are incorporating the drug and your base, then your base and drug should not get interacted with each other, as well as your base should not give the any kind of toxic effect on your skin. Then your base should be inert in nature. Then it should be non-irritating one, means it should not cause any kind of irritation to your skin. Then it should not be a non-sensitizing one, it should not produce any kind of sensation to your skin. Then it should have the good solvent as well as emulsifying agent. Then it should have the good emollient properties, good protective property to your skin, and it should be easily removed after the washing of that ointment. Because when you are preparing the ointment using that base, then after the application, it should be removed easily. So basically you are applying your base only, in the form of ointment, so that base should not react with your skin. Then your base should release your drug from your base when it is applied on your skin. Then there should be a pharmaceutical elegancy to the base. It means your base should be attractive in look, and your base should have the good stability. So these are the four bases generally we are using in case of your preparation of the semi-solid dosage forms, especially for the ointments as well as the suppositories. So water soluble bases, emulsion bases, absorption bases, oleaginous bases. So these four types of bases we are using for the preparation of ointment as well as the suppositories. So in the suppository also they can ask this question, types of bases, and in the your ointments also they can ask the question regarding the types of bases. So what are the particular specification or the qualities of that all the bases? So the first is the oleaginous base. The oleaginous base is basically hydrocarbons like mineral oils, petrol atom, paraffin waxes. When we are mixing the these materials, then we can prepare the your oleaginous type of base. Or oleaginous base is consist of mineral oils, petrol atoms, paraffins, as well as the various kind of waxes. Also we can use animal fats, vegetable oils. In the vegetable oils we can use the castor oil, cottonseed oil, olive oil. Then some nowadays synthetic esters are also there, like glycerol monostearate, butyl stearate, isopropyl lanolate, then stearyl alcohol. So this kind of material also we can use to prepare the your oleaginous base. So any one ingredient you can use as a base and it will be called as a oleaginous base. Or sometime combination of any two or three ingredients also we can use for the preparation of oleaginous base. Generally oleaginous bases are totally insoluble in water, or they are totally hydrophilic in nature. Most probably to develop the protective skin or the to develop the protective layer or the film on the, your skin, for that purpose we can use the oleaginous bases. Then another bases are like absorption base. These absorption bases are consist of hydrophilic petrol atom material, aqua for as well as the aqua base. So any one ingredient we can use as a absorption base. So these kind of bases are readily absorbed from the your skin. So it means we can say they are helping for the absorption of the drug from the skin. Then another base is the emulsion base. Emulsion base are also two types, water in oil base and oil in water base. In case of water in oil base, we can use the petrol atom, rose water, and we can prepare the base. Generally water in oil base is used for the preparation of your cold cream. Then oil in water base is using or is consist of the hydrophilic ointments as well as the vulva coal. So they are used for the vanishing cream purpose. Then another bases are the water soluble bases. Water soluble bases means they are easily soluble into the water. So most of water soluble drugs we are suppose want to deliver through the semi solid dosage form, then we can use the water soluble bases, because water soluble drugs can be easily incorporated in these bases. Generally water soluble bases consist of polyethylene glycol, then bioenzyme, then desinex, then vigum 5%. So generally these kind of materials are utilized to prepare the water soluble bases, and these bases are most probably suitable for water soluble drugs. Now another ingredient is your preservatives. Already I have told you that preservatives we are adding into their preparation for giving the protection to your product from the microorganisms. So examples are like methyl hydroxybenzoate, propyl hydroxybenzoate, chlorocresol, benzoic acid, phenyl mercuric nitrate, can be added as a preservative in the your semi solid dosage form. Then antioxidants are there. There are the three types of antioxidants are there because of their mechanism of action is different. Generally, antioxidant means those agents which can avoid the oxidation or which can stop the oxidation or which can avoid the oxidation of your product. Or generally, they will safeguard your drug from the oxidation. So this kind of agents are called as the antioxidants. And there are the three types of antioxidants generally we are using into the semi-solid dosage forms, like antioxidants, then reducing agents, and antioxidant synergistics. So generally, oxygen is the highly reactive atom that is capable of becoming of free radicals, or they are having the ability to prepare the free radical in your product. Then these free radicals can be capable of attacking to the neutrophilic structure of your drug, and your drug may become, we can say, useless because of the breakage of its bond, and structure of your drug will be changed because of the oxidation. If the drug structure has been changed, means your pharmacological action has been changed because its chemical nature has been changed. So that's why we have to avoid the oxidation. So examples of antioxidants are butylated hydroxy anisole, butylated hydroxy toluene can be added as a antioxidants. Then these three agents are there, like antigens, reducing agent, and antioxidant synergistics. So these are the three category of your antioxidants, because they are having the three different mechanism of action to avoid the oxidation. Generally, these antioxidants are acted by reacting with the free radicals. If the free radicals are produced in your product, then these antioxidants, if you are added, then they can stop these free radicals by reacting with that free radicals, and hence they can stop the oxidation of your product. Then another agents are reducing agents. These reducing agents are have the lower redox potential than the your drug. So because of the low redox potential, your free radical will react with your that reagent, and they will not react with your drug. Then antioxidant synergistic agents are there. They are added as an antioxidant in your product. So these agents are having the chelating or the sequestering agents. They can enhance the effect of antioxidants. So they are called as the synergistics. Means suppose you have added the already any other antioxidant, and you have added also antioxidant synergistics. So these agents will increase the activity of antioxidant agents. Examples are citric acid, tartaric acid, and lactisin. Simply, I would like to tell you that we have to add the antioxidant. So these are the examples of antioxidants, and they can play their role depending on their own structure. They may play their role as an antioxidant, or they may play their role as a reducing agent, or they may play their role as a synergistics. So they will finally or the ultimately avoid the oxidation of your product. Then humectants are there. These humectants are the hydroscopic substances. It is often a molecule with the several hydrophilic group and most often hydroxyl group. It means in the humectants, there is consist of the hydroxyl group. That's why they can absorb the moisture from the environment. So when they are added into your product, generally they will maintain the required moisture condition of your product, or they will prevent the dryness of your product. So by this way, these humectants will have the advantages in your product, like they will increase the solubility of your active ingredients, then they will elevate the skin penetration, as well as they will elevate the or increase the hydration of your skin. Now, what is the role of this humectant at the surface of the skin? If you are thinking that why they are increasing the solubility, what is the utilization? Suppose after the application of your semi-solid dosage form on your skin, if you are having the humectants, so these humectants will absorb the moisture and they will make available the required amount of water at your skin surface. and your drug which is you have added will get mixed with that water and it will get solubilized and it will be absorbed from your skin very quickly. And another advantage is that if your drug is get solubilized, then it will penetrate it from your skin very easily. As well as if the moisture is absorbed on your skin surface, then your skin will get hydrated. Once your skin is get hydrated, means it will get swell. Because of the swelling of your skin, the penetrability of your drug will get increased because your skin will become thin at the swollen part. That's why your drug will get easily entered or it will be easily penetrated inside your skin. So this is the utilization of your humectant after the application of your ointment or the cream on the surface also, as well as humectants are also useful inside the product also. So they will avoid the drying of your product. Then gelling agents. Gelling agents we are adding into the specially into the gels. These gelling agents forms a gel and dissolves in a liquid paste as a colloidal mixture. These are organic hydrocolloid materials or the hydrophilic inorganic substances. The examples of gelling agents are tragacanth, sodium alginate, pectin, gelatin, cellulose derivatives. Nowadays we are using the carbamor, synthetic materials are there. Then methyl cellulose, sodium alginates. Then emulsifying agents are there, especially in the cream, we require to add the emulsifying agents. Then there are the three types of emulsifying agents like anionic, cationic and non-anionic. So this alkyl sulfate, soaps are the examples of anionic. Cationic like quaternary ammonium compounds, alkyl, alkoxic, alkamines are the cationic type of emulsifying agents. Then non-anionic compounds like polyoxyethylene, alkyl, aryl ethers, then polyoxyethylene, then sorbitan esters. So these are the examples of non-ionic emulsifying agents. So these emulsifying agents are required to add into the your creams as well as sometime into the ointments also. Then buffering agents. Buffering agents are the those agents which are added into the preparation to avoid the changes in the pH of your product. The examples are sodium acetate, sodium citrate, potassium metaphosphate. Then permeation enhancers. Now what are the permeation enhancers? So these are the specific type of ingredients. When we are adding into the any kind of semi-solid dosage forms, then it will increase the permeation of your drug or it will increase the rate of permeation of your drug, means rate of transmission of drug inside your skin, and it will release your drug into the your bloodstream. So if without permeation enhancer, if you have prepared your semi-solid dosage forms, then it will take too much time to pass your drug inside your skin and the blood. Suppose you have added the permeation enhancer, then it will transmit your drug very fast from your skin into the blood. The examples of permeation enhancer are methanol, carvacrol, then limolin, graniol, oleic acid. So these are the particular type of permeation enhancers we are using with the particular type of drugs. Permeation enhancers generally we are adding into the ointments as well as the creams as well as the base gels and jellies. So for the all types of drugs not required the permeation enhancers, only for the those drugs whose permeation is very less or whose absorption is very less or the low, so in that case only we can use the permeation enhancers. Then method of preparations. Generally semi solid preparations are prepared by the four methods, or the ointments specially are prepared by the trituration methods. So trituration method means we have to take the your all the ingredients along with your drug and base, and we have to mix them into the your mortar with the help of pestle. So just by simply mixing we are preparing the your medicaments or the semi solid preparation, then that is called as the trituration. So ointments, creams and paste are prepared by this trituration method. Gels are not prepared by the trituration method. Then chemical reaction method. This chemical reaction method is utilized for the preparation of ointment and cream only. Okay, so in this case we are taking all the ingredients into the your mortar and pestle, and after just gentle mixing, that ingredients will react with each other and they will form the your ointment or the cream. So that type of method, when the your ingredients are getting react with each other and they are forming the your semi solid preparation, that method is called as chemical reaction method. Then another method is the fusion method. In the fusion method, generally we are increasing using the heat. Just we are melting the your all the ingredients which are we want to take. Then after the melting, we are mixing that ingredient, and that is called as the fusion method. Generally, in case of ointments, all the ingredients we are taking into the your petri dish, china dish, sorry, and then we are melting them as per the their melting point. And after the each and every ingredient has been melted, we are mixing it thoroughly with the help of stirrer. Then this method is called as the fusion method. In case of ointments, we can use this fusion method also. In case of cream and paste also, we can use the fusion method. Then emulsification method is also is there. Emulsification method is used for the ointment as well as the creams. So in the emulsification method, we are taking the all the ingredients like your oils as well as the your water soluble ingredients. First of all, in the preparation of your ointments and creams by emulsification method, all the ingredients we have to separate into the two phase, like oil soluble material and water soluble material. Separately, both the material we have to heat within the your china dish, and the after melting all the ingredients, we have to mix with each other. So just up to the 70 degree centigrade, we have to heat that both the material. Generally, whatever the oil soluble materials are there, they will get melted and they will liquefy. After that, the water soluble phase materials, we have to mix with them with the help of stirrer with the vigorous stirring. Then after that, we have to cool it. Then this method is called as the emulsification method. So this emulsification method is utilized for the preparation of ointments as well as the creams. Then equipments used for the preparation of the your ointments at the industry level or at the large scale production. Generally, it is very difficult to mix your semi-solid materials, because compared to the liquids as well as solids, it is very much difficult to mix totally or the to achieve the ideal mixing of all the ingredients. It is quite difficult. So in the large scale production, we are using the equipments for the mixing purpose. So we are using the agitator mixer as well as the shear mixer for the preparation of your ointments, creams, jellies. This is called as the sigma blade mixer. Generally, we are using for the preparation of your semi-solid dosage forms. Sigma blade mixer. Then colloidal mill is there. This is also used for the mixing of your material. In this colloidal mill, we are having the disc, and between these two discs, we have to incorporate your all the excipients, and then that disc will be rotated and it will mix the your all the ingredients. This is called as the colloidal mill. Then storage conditions of your semi-solid dosage forms. Generally, we have to keep your preparation at the cool and dry place, because if you are exposing your semi-solid preparation at the higher temperature, then they will get melt. So that's why your material will be not be able to show the pharmacological action, or you may not able to use it properly. That's why to maintain the its required consistency, we have to keep it at the cool and dry place. Then generally we have to use the wide mouth bottles for the storage of your preparation, because while application of that product, it should be easily taken by the your consumer. So wide mouth bottles are prepared, like Zendu Balm bottle is there, or your Pond's cream is there, which is having the wide mouth. So they will be easily accessible by the your for the your consumers. As well as nowadays, we are having the collapsible plastic tubes for the storage of the your creams. Okay, so easily we can squeeze or press them and your product will come out from your plastic container. So these are the your storage conditions of your semi-solid preparations. Evaluation of the semi-solid dosage form. Evaluation means simply we are going to check quality of your product, whether your product is prepared as per the your requirement or not. Requirement means there are the various types of tests which are given in the official books. So your prepared dosage form must compatible or comply with the all the standards which are prescribed by the official books or the official standards. Official books means your Indian Pharmacopoeia, British Pharmacopoeia. So they have designed the various kind of test, and your product should comply with the that all the test. And when we are going to test your product, it means we are going to evaluate your product. Simply we are going to check the qualitative as well as quantitative parameters of your products. In case of evaluation of the semi-solid dosage forms, there are the different types of evaluation test for the ointments, for the creams, for the gels. So some tests are a little bit different, but most of tests are near to same for the say, cream, ointments as well as the gel. Now first of all we'll see regarding the evaluation of your ointments. When we have prepared the your ointments, then first test we have to check regarding the its penetration rate. Then we have to check about the rate of drug release from the your ointment. Then we have to check the absorption rate of your ointment. Then we have to check about the irritant effect of that ointment. So these are the four tests generally we have to carry out for the ointment. And after that we can check the viscosity of your ointment, then spreadability of the your ointment. Viscosity means how much it is viscous. Then spreadability means whether your ointment is easy to spread on your skin or not. So these all the tests we have to perform. Then after that squeezing test is also is there. In this test we'll check the after the gentle pressing of your tube whether the sufficient amount of ointment is coming out on your finger or not. So these all the tests we have to perform on the, your ointment. Some tests are common for the gel, for the cream and ointment. So first test we'll see regarding the your penetration. Now what is mean by the penetration? Penetration means when you are applying the your ointment on the skin, so at which rate it is getting penetrated inside the your skin, and through the skin at which rate or how much amount, at which speed it is releasing inside the your blood. So that is called as the penetration of your ointment. Penetration means another way we can say transmission of your drug from the ointment into the your blood, that is called as the penetration. So suppose the sufficient amount of the drug is not penetrated inside your blood, then you will not get the required result. So that's why penetration is most important. Penetration means there is the entry of your drug inside your blood through the your skin barrier. Your skin is acting as always barrier. Your skin is also acting as a protective layer for your body. So it will not allow easily any kind of foreign substance. So that's why there is the great challenge for any kind of drug, for any kind of substance to cross your skin and to reach into the bloodstream. Because your skin is playing a role of protection, and if your drug is not able to cross that skin, then you will not get the ultimate result. So we have to check the rate of penetration of your drug. Then next test is the rate of drug release. So if you have applied your ointment, and in the ointment we have mixed your base as well as the drug. Now when we are mixing your drug with the base and we are making the ointment, then after the application of that total medicament or the total ointment on the your skin, after the some time your drug will try to melt at the surface of the skin, and it will try to penetrate or it will try to release from the base into the your skin, and after that it will release through the your blood. So here again the same case, how much amount of drug has been released from the base or from the total ointment inside the body, that is also important. So here rate of drug release means at how much amount your drug is releasing directly into the blood from the, your ointment, that is we have to note down. So that is called as the rate of drug release. Then next is the absorption. Absorption means same thing, that at which amount your drug is getting absorbed by the, your skin. It means if the, your skin is giving the access to the drug, then only your drug will get absorbed, and then after the absorption of the drug through the skin, then only it will transmitted inside the, your blood. Because there are the several skin barriers, because of that barriers your drug cannot easily pass through the, your skin. Then next one is the irritant effect. Irritant effect means after the application of your ointment, whether your ointment is producing any kind of irritation or any kind of sensation to the, your skin, that we have to check. Otherwise, if without testing the your irritant effect, you have supplied that ointment to the people and they are getting the irritation problem, then that batch will be the useless. So prior to selling of your ointment, after the preparation of ointment, we have to check the its irritant effect, whether it is causing any irritation or not. Most probably we have to check that whether it is having the any kind of irritation effect, any kind of swelling effect, any kind of we can say allergic reaction on to the body. So that all those things we have to check for the ointment, cream, as well as also gel. So how to carry out this test? First thing I would like to tell you that the ointment evaluation, we require the any kind of artificial skin, or the we can say you can take the any kind of egg membrane also. So in this case we have to design the your experiment. In the experiment there are the dissolution test apparatus available, diffusion test apparatus are available for the testing of the ointments. So in this case, first thing we have to check that we have to take the one test tube, and on the one end of the test tube we can bind the your membrane or the egg membrane, and that test tube we have to dip into the one beaker, and in that beaker we have to take the 100 ml of water, distilled water. And then after dipping of your test tube, what will happen, the water will come inside your test tube. Then after that, some 1 gram of the ointment or the sufficient quantity of ointment we can add into that test tube, or instead of test tube we can have the diffusion test apparatus also. In that apparatus there are the two chambers. In the two chambers, both the chambers are having the separate regions, donor region and receiver regions. These both the chambers we have to join to each other, and we have to make the one barrier in that both the chamber, that is the one egg membrane or the parchment membrane. Simply we have to add the water into the both the chamber from one side and another side, and in one chamber we just add your drug. Now drug means your ointment, sorry. When you are adding the 1 gram of ointment one side of the chamber, what will happen, after some period your ointment will try to dissolve in that one chamber in which we have added it. Now after that your drug will try to slowly pass through the that chamber. Then that drug will pass through that membrane, and it will try to cross that membrane from one chamber to the another chamber. Now depending on the its ability, whether it is having the penetration toward that it is having the ability to cross that membrane or not, we have to it is depend on the its chemical nature. Or simply we can assume that suppose you have applied your ointment on the, your skin, then depending on the, its chemical nature, so it will, whether it will cross the, your skin or not, that we are checking into the that chamber. Now there are the several other reasons also, like your which type of base you have used for the preparation of your ointment, as well as what is the solubility of your drug, that is also matters. So depending on that factors, it will cross the your membrane. Then how much amount of drug has been passed from one chamber to the another chamber, so that is called as the penetration. And the same result you will get the, that is how much amount of drug has been released from the your ointment to the another chamber, or also we can say how much amount of drug has been absorbed. Now after the transmission of your drug from one chamber to the another chamber, From the second chamber, we can take the just sample of 1 ml and we can test that second chambers that how much amount of drug has been transmitted from one chamber to the another chamber after crossing the membrane. Then that amount, how much amount has been crossed, so it will give the idea that initially suppose you have taken the 1 gram and in the first test or in the first sample, how much amount has been got in the second chamber, you can just get calculation and then you can make the assumption that how much amount of drug has been crossed. In the percentage, you will get the results. Or simply, if you want to check the directly on the animals, so that is called as the in vivo study. Take the any kind of animal like a rabbit or the rat, we can check. Just on the surface of the rabbit, just remove the hairs and make the skin free of hair and just apply the some amount of ointment on its one patch. Just particular amount like 1 gram or 500 milligram of ointment you can apply. Now after the application, wait for the half an hour and just take the blood sample of that rabbit. Now what will happen? You have applied it on the skin of that rabbit, then your drug will cross the skin barrier and it will reach into the your blood of the rabbit. If you are taking the blood samples of that rabbit and you are going to check the, suppose you have checked the blood sample, how much amount of drug has been released into the blood, then you will get the idea that initially you have applied suppose 1 gram of the ointment on the surface of the rabbit and how much amount drug is released inside its blood, then you can also make the calculation. So by this way, you will get the idea about the penetration rate of the drug per minute, how much drug has been released, or per hour, how much amount of the drug has been released, as well as you will get the idea about the rate of the drug release, means at which speed your drug is releasing from the ointment inside the body, as well as you will get the idea that how much amount of drug has been absorbed through the your skin of that rabbit. And in the another way also, we can get the idea that is there any kind of irritation effect on the surface of the your rabbit. Suppose is there any kind of irritation persists, then it will show on the rabbit skin that there is the redness or the inflammation or the edema. So any kind of allergic reaction may be possible if the your ointment is allergic in nature. So by this way, we can check penetration rate, rate of drug release, then absorption time, then irritant effect. So by this way, we can evaluate your ointment for the various kind of test. Just simply just take the any kind of rabbit, remove the hairs, apply the your ointment and wait for the while and take the blood samples of that rabbit. You can take the sampling up to the 1 hour also by making the interval of 10 minutes. First 10 minutes, you just take the 1 ml of blood of that rabbit and go for the testing of that blood, how much amount of drug is present. Then after 10 minutes also, we can take the second sample and you can check the how much amount of drug has been present. Again, after 30 minutes also, you can check the, take the sample of that rabbit. Again, you can check the how much concentration of drug present in the third sample. So likewise, up to the 1 hour or the 2 hour also, with the interval of 10 minutes, we can take the sample and you can take the concentration of that sample. If you have the concentration of the samples, then you can plot the that concentration versus the time. So in first initial 10 minutes, how much amount of drug release, second 10 minutes, how much amount of drug release, third 10 minutes, how much amount of drug release. So likewise, you can plot the graph. Now you will find that initially there will be the very less amount of drug will be released. Then in the second 10 minutes, you will get the little bit amount of drug. In the third 10 minutes, you will get the more concentration of the drug. In the fourth 10 minutes, you will get the again more concentration of the drug. Then after the fifth sample, you will find that there is a decline of the drug release, because when you have applied your ointment on the surface of the rabbit, so slowly your drug will release into the skin and it will transmit into the blood. So after particular time, the total applied drug will be finished. Then your concentration into the last two or three samples will be less. So by this way, we can plot the graph of your drug versus time, concentration of the drug versus time, and you can plot the graph. And you will get the idea that how much amount of drug has been totally present in the blood in the 1 hour, how much time is required to release your drug from the ointment into the blood, that will also you will get the idea, as well as the what is the absorption rate of the drug into the your skin, that will also you will get the idea from the same experiment, as well as you will get the idea about the irritation effect of that drug or the irritation effect of that ointment on the that rabbit also. So by this way we can judge the 3 to 4 factors from the one single experiment. But generally we used to carry out the same experiment only by using the one diffusion cell. So here without using animal generally we are going to carry out that experiments, but instead of that cell suppose you are using the animals, then also you will get the idea about this test. So this was about the evaluation of the semi solid preparation of the ointments, as well as suppose you want to check the viscosity of the ointments, then also you can check the viscosity. Simply take the little bit amount of the ointment and use the any kind of viscometer. Generally we are using the Brookfield viscometer to check the viscosity of ointment, gel, as well as the cream. So in that equipment just we have to take the some amount of your dosage form like ointment, cream, as well as the your gel, and there is the one spindle, we have to dip that spindle into the your ointment and we have to run that apparatus, and after running that apparatus you will get idea about the what is the viscosity of your preparation. So simply by using the Brookfield viscometer or any kind of suitable viscometer we can find out the viscosity of your ointment. Another test is that squeezing test is there. If you have filled your ointment into the collapsible tubes, collapsible tubes means there are the today we are filling the your toothpaste in that tubes, so they are called as the collapsible tubes. So this test is performed for the your container. So why we are to perform this test? Because after filling of your ointment, so for the daily routine utilization purpose, whether after just gentle pressing some amount of ointment will be come out from your container or not. So for the collapsible tubes only this test has been prepared. So just fill up the your preparation into the your collapsible tubes, then pack it from the back side, and then from the upper side just open the your closure and then press gently your tube and measure how much amount of ointment is coming out from the your mouth of that collapsible tube, whether that amount of that material is sufficient for application or not. So this test is given for the only container. If the sufficient amount of container material is coming out, then your container is okay for the your preparation. If sufficient amount of material is not coming out, then you have to change the your container. So better way we can use the wide mouth bottle for your ointments. Then evaluation of the creams. So evaluation of the creams are also near to same as like as your ointments, but typical some tests are different. In case of evaluation of the creams, generally we are applying the creams most probably on the your face. We are having the different types of cream which are specially designed for the your cosmetic creams. So whenever we are testing for the creams, so we have to check its rheology means viscosity, as well as its sensitivity and biological testing. So generally creams are your oil in water mixture, so that's why microbes may be developed in the your cream. That's why we have to check the presence of microbes also. So in the cream, first of all we can check the its viscosity or the rheology by using the any kind of viscometer, as I have told you in the your ointments. Take the sufficient amount of the cream and dip the spindle of the your Brookfield viscometer and run the viscometer, and then you will get the idea about the its viscosity and its rheology. Then sensitivity test. Sensitivity means after the application of the cream, is there any kind of allergic reaction is persist on the screen or not. So this test we can carried out by using the your rabbits. Just take the some amount of cream and apply it on the your rabbit. Suppose you want to test it, means first of all you have to remove the hairs and you have to make the patch on the surface of the skin of the rabbit, and then apply your some small amount of the cream and wait for the while and check the any kind of sensation is persist on the skin or not. Simply is there any kind of red skin is there, or any kind of edema, any kind of swelling is there. So this kind of changes will give you idea whether your skin is sensible or not. Generally, there should not be such kind of symptoms. Then only we can say your cream is safe. Then biological testings is there. In the biological testing, we can go for the checking of the presence of microbes in the your cream, as well as we can apply it on the your skin of the rabbit, as well as we can check it the for the absorption of the cream also, as like as your ointment. So in the biological testing, generally we are going to check the presence of microbes. So suppose in the your prepared cream, is there any kind of attack of microorganism, then how to check it? So for that purpose, we have to use the one nutrient broth media. Media means in which your microbes can grow very easily. So such kind of nutrient broth media we can take, and in that media just add the your sufficient amount of sample of the cream and keep it for the inoculation and incubator. So in the incubator, when we have kept the your material in the nutrient broth, suppose you have added your small amount of cream, so after the 24 hours you will find that if the microbes are present in your cream, they will grow because of the nutrient broth, and if the microbes are absent, there will not be any kind of growth. If the microbe are present and they are grown, it means your total material will become turbid, and if you will observe through the microscope, then you will find that there are the development of microorganism is occurred. So by this way, we can check the your creams for the biological testing. Then paste is there. Now paste is very, we can say, thick material which is utilized for the your protection purpose. Just simply we have to make the thin layer on your skin. Most probably your cricketers, they are sport persons are there. Generally they used to apply the such kind of paste on their skin, and they go for the protection for the skin from the your sunlight. So in many kind of sports events, you might be seen that there are the several patches on their hands. So these are nothing but your paste. Just they have applied for the protection purpose. Now after the preparation of your paste, we have to go for the checking of its various kind of qualitative test. So first thing is regarding the abrasiveness test. Now abrasiveness means what? Abrasiveness means if your paste is containing the some crystal material or the your soluble particles are there. So after the application of the paste, they may scratch your skin. So your paste is having the ability to scratch your skin or not. So that we have to check. That is called as the abrasiveness. So after the simply just take the your paste and apply it on your skin, and then you can feel whether it is having the abrasiveness or not. If it is giving the scratching type of feeling, then you can say that there is the abrasive material is present in the your paste. Also the same test you can check or perform by using the another instrument. Just simply take the one glass slide and apply the one nail polish on the your glass slide and just allow it to dry. Now after the drying of nail polish, it will deposit the thin layer on the your glass slide. Now take the small amount of the paste and rub it on the glass slide. Now what will happen after that rubbing of your paste on the glass slide, just wash out it and then observe the your glass slide. Already we have applied the your small amount of nail polish or the film of that nail polish. If the scratches are there on the film, then you can find that some amount of nail polish has been removed because of the scratching of that your abrasive material. So by this way, we can check the abrasiveness of the your paste. This test, why we are performing? Because we are applying your paste on the skin. If in the paste some abrasive materials are present or the crystals are present, then they can scratch the your skin. So to avoid these things, we have to conduct this test. If the abrasive material is present in your paste, then you should reject this paste. Then another test is the particle size. Now already we have told that while preparing your paste, we are making the insoluble materials or the particles inside your paste. So after the preparation of your paste, whatever the solid particles are present, so what is the particle size of that material we have to check. Now simply to find out the particle size, just dilute your paste with the help of water. Now, after the dilution, what will happen? Some material will dissolve into the your water, and some material which is insoluble, they will remain as it is in that solution. Now, filter out that material, separate the your particles, and then measure the size of that particle with the help of microscope, or also we can use the sieves. But it will be better that with the help of microscope, we can find out the particle size of that material. So by this way, we can find out in microns your particle size. Then cleansing property. If your paste is having the cleansing property, then we can check it for the cleansing also. Or after the application of the paste, whether it will be easily removed from the your skin or not, that we have to check. Just take the simply some amount of water after the application of your paste on your skin. Just try to wash out it after drying. Then whether it is easily removing or not, that we have to find out. Because after the your application of the paste, you may require it for the 2 to 3 hours. Then after the your work, you have to remove it from your skin. So it should be easily removed. That's why whether it is having the ability to remove from your skin very easily or not, that we have to check. Then consistency. Consistency means simply viscosity. So for the checking of the consistency, we can use the any kind of viscometer and we can find out its viscosity. Then pH of the your paste. pH of the your paste, we can check, just take the some amount of paste and dilute. Take the 1 gram of your paste and dilute it with the up to water up to the 100 ml. Just after dilution of the water, it will become liquefied. So that solution we can check by using the pH meter, as well as there is the pH paper also available. So if you are dipping your pH meter, then you will get the idea about the what is its pH. Then foaming character of your paste. After the dilution of the paste, 1 gram of the paste, suppose you are diluting with the 100 ml of water, then whether it is having the ability to produce the foam or not, that we can find out. So generally, this foaming character is utilized for the those paste which are utilized for the toothpaste or the cleaning of the tooth. So there should be the little bit amount of foam produced by your paste. So this foaming character is carried out for the those paste which are utilized for the cleansing of the tooth, means your normal toothpaste purpose. Then limit test for the arsenic as well as the lead. Now this is the one chemical test. This test is designed to find out the presence of lead or the harmful material, metallic material inside your paste. So in this test, we have to take the some chemical ingredients which can react with the lead, and they will show the colorful colors. Then we can identify some amount of harmful metals are present in your paste. Actually, when we are preparing the paste, whatever the excipients we are utilizing, most of excipients are earth originated. Earth originated means we have obtained them from the earth. So naturally, that material may contain the lead, that is the poisonic type of substance. So it is present in that material means when we are utilizing that excipients for the preparation of paste, so naturally that material will also come into your paste, or that lead may come into your paste. So prior to utilization of your paste, we have to check presence of such kind of arsenic material or the lead, because this arsenic as well as lead is harmful to your public health. So that's why prior to utilization of the paste, we should check the presence of such kind of arsenic as well as lead material. If there is the arsenic or lead is present, then we should not use such kind of paste. Then another test is the volatile material or the content of the volatile material into your paste. So in the your paste, how much amount of volatile material is present or the volatile excipients are present, that we can checking of the volatile matters as well as the presence of moisture into your paste. Now suppose you have prepared your test, then you may check the presence of how much amount of volatile material is there and how much amount of moisture or the non-volatile material is there. So simply to check it, just take the 1 gram of your paste and take the its weight. Now it is suppose 1 gram, then just allow to heat that paste on the, your using your china dish. So in the china dish, suppose you have taken the 1 gram of the paste, heat it on the flame. Now because of the heating, what will happen? Whatever the volatile material is there, it will be easily removed. Then remaining material will be there that we have to re-weight it. Now from the 1 gram, how much amount of material has been released into the air because of the heating, so that we can calculate just after the re-weighting. Suppose it is initially it was 1 gram, then after the heating, suppose it is 800 milligram, then it means that 200 milligram was the volatile material and rest of material was the non-volatile one. So by this way we can check it. Then effect of the special type of ingredients. Suppose in your paste you have added the any kind of antioxidant to avoid the oxidation, so we can check the effect of that ingredient also. Suppose in your paste we have added the any kind of preservative material, that is antimicrobial agent, so that one also we can check. Suppose any antimicrobial agent you was added, whether that antimicrobial agent is working or not. So to find out that, just take the some amount of your paste and take the your nutrient broth media. Nutrient broth media means in which your microbes can well grow. Now in the nutrient broth media, add the your paste and allow it for the incubation. Now after some time you can add the some microbes into that paste, into that total nutrient broth media. Now if the microbes are added, then they will try to develop, but because of presence of the antimicrobial agent in your paste, the microbes will not be grown. Their growth will be inhibited because in your paste there is the presence of antimicrobial agent. So that's why your preservative or the antimicrobial agent is working. That can be checked by using this experiment. So this was the test for the your paste. I would like to again explain regarding the foaming characteristics. Now suppose you have prepared the toothpaste, because dosage form is near to same, so whether it is foaming, producing foam or not. So to check it, take little bit 1 gram of your paste and add the 100 ml of water and shake it. Now after the shaking of your paste with the water, what will happen? In your paste there is the presence of surface acting agent. So because of the presence of surface acting agent, foam should be developed. If the foam is developed, means how much amount of foam has been developed and how much time is required to develop that foam, we can note down. So that this will give you idea whether the surface acting agent is working properly or not, whether the you have added the proper surface acting agent or not. So this kind of idea you will get. As well as in case of cleansing property, again I would like to explain these characteristics. Suppose you have prepared the such kind of toothpaste and you want to check the cleansing property, whether it is having the ability to clean your tooth or not. So for that purpose we can take the artificial tooth which are already yellowish in color. Now rub your paste on the tooth and brush it with the help of any kind of brush, and use the little bit amount of water. Then after the brushing, just wash out with the some amount of water, and then you can find out the effect of your paste, whether your artificial teeth has shiny look or not, whether the yellowishness is removed or not. So by this way we can check the your toothpaste for this cleansing property. Not all the paste should be checked for the cleansing property, only the those paste which are made for the cleansing purpose, that paste only we can check for the cleansing property. So these are the various kind of, we can say, tests which are designed for your paste. Now the evaluation of the gel. Suppose you have prepared the gel and you want to evaluate it for the various kind of parameters. So first of all, we can check it for the drug content. Now drug content means how much amount of drug has been present in your gel. So this test is applicable for ointment, cream, as well as your paste also, if you have added the any kind of drug. Now why we have to check it? Because while preparing, suppose in the formula it is given that you have to take the 100 milligram of the drug and remaining ingredient you are going to measure. Now while preparing, what happens? when you are adding your drug, suppose you have already measured the 100 mg of drug and you are going to add it into your product. Now while addition of that drug, some drug may be lost while addition of your procedure. So some amount of drug may stick to your container, some amount of drug may remain on the butter paper. So exactly 100 mg of drug is present in your product or not, that we have to check. Because on the label, what you will label or what you will write in this prepared gel, you have added the 100 mg of the drug. Now exactly 100 mg of drug is present or not, or some amount of is less. Sometime what happens while mixing up your drug into your gel or into your base, it may stick to your stirrer. So I would like to tell you that sometimes 0.1 milligram or 0.2 milligram may be less. So exactly 100 milligram may not be there into your final product, because while mixing up your drug, they may wasted into your various kind of procedure, means while transmission, while mixing, some amount of drug has been lost or it had become wastage, or it may stick to your container. That's why for any kind of product, we have to check the drug content. Now how to check the drug content? So for the each and every drug, there is the assay procedure is exist. Assay procedure means it is already developed procedures. Suppose you are having any kind of drug, then we can go for this assay procedure by chemical reaction. Suppose you have added the paracetamol into your dosage form or into your gel, then what is the assay procedure is available for the paracetamol? So by the same procedure, we can check your gel. Then you will get the idea that how much amount of drug is present in your gel. So same procedure also we can carry out for the all kind of dosage form. So by checking the assay of that particular drug, we can check presence of amount of that drug. So we can get idea that whether the 100% drug is present, whether the 98% drug is present, whether the 97% drug is present in your product. So by using the assay procedure, we can go for the checking of drug content of dosage form. Then pH. The pH of gel, pH of ointment, pH of cream, pH of your paste can be tested by the same procedure. Just take the 10 gram of your material and dilute it up to the 100 ml. Just make the liquid of that product and check with the help of pH meter. Then you can find out the pH of your product. Then viscosity of the gel. Viscosity of the gel can be determined by using the viscometer. Just take the some amount of the gel and dip the spindle of viscometer and run the your viscometer and find out the viscosity of your gel. Then spreadability. Now spreadability is very much important. It is applicable for the cream also. It is applicable for the ointment also. It is applicable for the paste as well as the gel. Now how to check the spreadability? To check the spreadability, just take the two glass slides. On the one glass slide, at the one end, apply the your product like 2 drop, 3 drop, or sufficient quantity of your gel. We can pour like 100 mg, 200 mg milligram of the gel we can add. And with the help of second slide, just try to spread it on the your one slide. So whether after spreading, it is spreading overall the your first slide or not, just we have to find out. With the help of second slide, just try to spread the your gel, whether it is spreading on the your slide uniformly or not, that we can find out. If it is not properly spreading, means your drug or your dosage form is not having the good spreadability. If it is spreading very easily and it is covering all the slide uniformly without any portion, then we can say that your dosage form is having the very good spreadability. For all kind of viscous dosage form, spreadability has been conducted for the gel, for the cream, for the your paste, and for the ointment also. Because this preparation we are spreading on the your skin, so that's why it should have the good spreadability. Then extrudability. Extrudability means after the filling of your product inside the collapsible tube, whether it is coming out from the tube or not very easily, that is called as the extrudability. Suppose you have filled your gel into the collapsible tube, and after the filling, when you want to use that gel, just by gentle pressing, your product is coming out from your product or not, that is called as the extrudability test. Just fill the, your product into the collapsible tube and then press it gently by your hands, and then how much amount of product is coming out from the your tube, that we have to find out whether that amount which is coming out from your tube is sufficient for you or not. Then another test is called as the homogeneity of the drug content. It means whether the your drug is totally mixed inside your product or not, that is called as the homogeneity of the drug content. Because already I have told you that while mixing of the drug into the semi-solid product, it is very difficult task, because mixing or the uniform mixing of your product is very difficult. In case of liquids, suppose you have added the your drug, it will be easily mixed in the total throughout the your vehicle very easily. But in case of the your semi-solid product, it is quite difficult. So after the final preparation of your product, just take the your some amount of product and go for the assay. So for the checking of the homogeneity, take the sample of your product from the different parts of your container, from the bottom side, from the middle side, and from the upper side. Just take the three samples and go for the checking of the assay. Then you will get idea that your how much amount of drug is present at the middle portion of your total product, at the top side of your product, at the bottom of the product. So there should be the equal concentration of the drug present at the all side of your container. Then only we can say that your product is totally or uniformly mixed. So these are the various tests which are meant for the evaluation of the gel, that is drug content, pH, viscosity, spreadability, extrudability, homogeneity of the drug content. So these all the tests are near to same for the your ointment, cream, gel, as well as the paste. This is the Brookfield viscometer. Generally we are using for the testing of the your viscosity of the your product. These are the different spindles which are utilizing for the dipping inside your product. See, this is the viscometer. In our institute we are having this Brookfield viscometer that I have told you that we have to use the penetrating enhancers in the various kind of ointments or in the gels also or in the creams. Now what are these exactly penetrating enhancers? Now penetration enhancer are means the those ingredients which can increase the penetration rate of your drug into the skin. It means they are helping to penetrate your drug inside the skin. And what is the mechanism of this penetrating enhancers, or by which way they are going to help your drug to penetrate inside your skin? So first of all, I would like to tell you about the skin anatomy. There are the three layers of your skin, that is epidermis, dermis, and subcutaneous fatty tissues. So your tissue is having the different three regions. First region is the epidermis, second region is the dermis, and last one is the fatty tissues. So depending on the nature of your drug, the access of the drug will be varied. If the your drug is having the water solubility, then initially it will insert inside your epidermis layer. But after the epidermis and dermis layer, there is the third layer that is called as the subcutaneous fatty tissues. This fatty tissues means it is having the lipidic content. Suppose your drug is traveled up to the second layer, but in the third layer, there will be the, we can say, barrier for that drug, because fatty tissues will repel your drug outside the, your drug. So that's why it is very difficult to insert your drug inside the third layer. If the drug is oilic or the lipidic soluble or the oil soluble, then initially at the epidermis and dermis layer, there itself your drug has been rejected. So it is depending on the structure of your drug and nature of your drug, whether it is having the lipidic soluble or oil soluble or water soluble nature. So depending on that, your drug will be penetrated through your skin. Or some drugs are having the both affinity or the both the solubility, like water solubility as well as the oil solubility, means it is called as the partition coefficient. Partition coefficient means affinity of drug towards the oil phase as well as the water phase. Your skin is made up of most probably oily material or the lipidic material. If your drug is having the both nature, then your drug will very fastly cross the your skin and it will reach into the your skin blood. So for that type of drug, you will have the very good results. See, this is the your skin anatomy, that is the stratum corneum, viable epidermis and dermis. As well as in your skin, there are the presence of your hair shaft, then sweat glands, then hair follicles, as well as the some nerves and the normal skin. So in the epidermis and dermis layer, there are the very dead, or we can say cells are present, as well as the hair shaft are present. So another I would like to tell you that some sweat glands are also present. These sweat glands are present into the dermis, but their openings are at the dermis, epidermis, as well as your hair shafts are there, or the hair follicles are there. So that hair follicles or the hairs are open at the your epidermis, but their bottom is present at the dermis, or at the bottom of the dermis. So after the application of your drug, it may travels through the your pores or the nearby your hair, or it may travels through the your sweat gland channels. So through these channels, generally your drug is you can say administered inside your skin, and it will transmitted to the your nerves, and it will transmitted to the your we can say very small veins or the capillaries, and then it will go into the your finally blood. Now how the your drug has been we can say absorbed through the your skin. Generally when we are applying your ointment, cream or the gel on the top of the your skin layer, so your drug will get melt, and it will try to transmit towards the your skin. So generally it involves the passive diffusion of your drug. So generally transmission of the drug is called as the diffusion of the drug. Then this diffusion is takes place by the passive way, generally intracellular penetration and intercellular penetration is takes place, or sometimes transappendageal penetration is also takes place. Means there are the two mechanisms. First mechanism is called as the transcorneal penetration. In the transcorneal penetration, there might be chances that your drug may transmit through the cells, means intracellular, from one cell to the another cell and another cell to the next cell. Otherwise it may transmitted through the extracellular fluid, that is intercellular fluid, means gap between the two cells. So like this I have shown here, that between the cells also it can be passed, means whatever the adjacent volume is there between the two cells, so the gap between the two cells, through that gap also your drug may be transmitted, or it may be transmitted from the one cell to the another cell. So these are the different mechanism by which your drug may be transmitted from upper layer to the bottom layer of the your skin. Now what are the factors which are affecting on the penetration of your drug, or the which kind of factors affect on the percutaneous absorption of your drug? That already I have told you that depending on the nature of your drug, it may have the different types of rate of absorption. So first factor is the solubility of drug in the stratum corneum. So that is the outermost layer of your skin. Whether your drug is having the solubility in that layer or not, if your drug is having the solubility, then absorption of drug will be the very fast. Then another factor is the diffusion through the stratum corneum. So after the solubilization of the drug into the stratum corneum layer, whether your stratum corneum is releasing your drug into the next layer or not. So that also factor affect on the total penetration or the total diffusion of your drug through the skin. Then next is the partitioning of your drug. Partitioning means whether your drug is having the affinity towards the both the lipidic and non-lipidic layer of the skin or not. Suppose your drug is having the more affinity to the only lipidic layer, then only at the lipidic layer your drug will be passed. But when the non-lipidic layer will be there in the your skin, so there your drug will be rejected. Very small amount of drug will be absorbed through the your non-lipidic material of the your skin. Then diffusion through the viable skin tissues. Now see here, in your skin uppermost layer are the non-viable layers of the your skin, or the most of the dead cell are present. But in the dermis and after the dermis, subcutaneous layer are there. So there are called as the viable tissue layer, or the they are live tissues. So in the live tissues, most of drugs are we can say rejected, and most of drugs are we can say accepted also. So how much amount of drug will be accepted in the your viable region of the skin? So depending on that, your drug penetration will be there. Then condition of the skin. Now it is also most important parameter. Condition of the skin means sometimes, suppose at the affected parts you have applied your ointment, and suppose your total skin is removed because of the friction, if you are having the wounds and you have applied your ointments. Now there is no any barrier because there is no skin is present on that particular area. So directly your material is applied on the affected part means it is directly having the access toward the your blood. And suppose another case, suppose your skin is just ruptured upper part, so your drug will have the very less barrier toward the your blood. Another case, suppose your skin is hydrated, your skin is normal, but you have poured the much amount of water on the your skin, so it will get swell. It is called as the hydration of the skin. So generally skin will try to absorb the some amount of water, and because of the absorption of water, your skin will become swell. Just pour the some amount of water on the your skin, it will let it swell, and when the your skin is become swell, it is called as the hydrated skin. And because of the swelling of the skin, if you are applying the ointment on the swell skin, then your ointment will have the more penetration, because of the swelling your all the cells are get swelled, and thickness of their membrane will be become, we can say, less. So your drug will become more penetrable from the this such kind of hydrated skin. So depending on the such kind of condition, penetration of the ointment or the penetration of the drug through the ointment or the through the cream will be different. If you are applying on the affected part and non affected part, penetration will be the different in the both the cases. So such kind of factor or the such kind of parameter will affect on the penetration of the drug. Then effect of the moisture. How much amount of moisture is present in your ointment or at the site of your skin, that will give the effect on the penetration of your drug. If the moisture is present more, means skin will hydrated and more amount of drug can be penetrated to the your skin. If your drug is oil soluble and moisture is present, means your drug will not be absorbed, because your oil soluble drug will repel because of that moisture. Then effect of vehicles. Vehicle means what kind of basis you are utilized for the your preparation of ointment or the your creams. Suppose you are having the emulsifying basis, then your ointment will be fastly absorbed through the your skin. If you are water soluble basis you have used, then very less amount of drug will be absorbed from your skin. So depending on the vehicles or the depending on the type of basis you have used, so the penetration will be the different. Then effect of concentration of medicament. Now concentration of medicaments means amount of medicament. Now suppose you have applied 1 gram of the drug, 1 gram of the ointment, and another side you have applied the suppose 2 gram of ointment. Suppose at the different part you have applied the different concentration, means what happened at the site where the more amount of amount of medicament is there, then absorption will be the fast. So depending on the concentration gradient, the transmission of ointment will takes place more. If the ointment concentration is less at the top of the your skin, then penetration will be the very slow. Then effect of surface acting agent. If your ointment or the if your cream is having the content of surfactant or the surface acting agent, then your penetration will be the more. If the concentration of surfactant is less, then penetration will be the less. So these are the different types of factors which are affecting on the rate of penetration of the drug through the semi solid dosage form. See, these are the transport mechanisms. This is called as the passive diffusion of the drug from the, your various types of pathways. This is the, your skin structure. Suppose you have applied the your material or the ointment or the semi solid dosage form on the your skin at the upper layer. So by the different ways your drug may pass into the your blood. There are the various pathways, like through the sebaceous gland, through the hair follicle, through the sweat glands, as well as through the your cells. Your drug may travel from the your skin up to the your blood. This is called as the intracellular route or the transcellular route. Intracellular means between the gap of the cells. From the upper layer, your drug may pass through the between the space of the cells up to the your blood, or directly it may transmit from one cell to the another cell. Generally, when we are using the penetrating enhancers, so they will try to increase the rate of penetration of the drug through the your skin. Already we have seen the number of we can say barriers, or the we have seen that how the your drug is used to travel from the your skin upper layer to the down layer. So while transmission of the or while traveling of the drug, there are so many barriers which may affect on the penetration, we have seen. But when we are using the penetrating enhancer or the one particular type of excipients along with the your drug, then they will help to penetrate the your drug very fast. So what is the mechanism by which your penetrating enhancer will try to help your drug? The first mechanism is the chemical penetration enhancer. Second one is the gentle heating mechanism, and third one is the ionotophoresis. Generally, these three mechanisms we are using to penetrate more drug inside your skin. Generally, penetration technique has been developed to improve the viability of your drug, or to increase the rate of drug penetration inside your skin or to the your blood. Generally, this penetration enhancer or this specially type of agents are we are using to increase the penetration of the drug through the your skin, and to avoid the various kind of barriers, or the to avoid the various kind of resistance to the your drug. Generally, these penetrating enhancers or this reagent will increase your drug penetration through the skin by various kind of ways. Generally, these penetrating enhancers will increase the diffusion coefficient of your drug. It means they will chemically react with your drug, and they will try to increase the diffusion coefficient of your drug, and hence your drug absorption will be the increased. Sometimes they may increase the your penetration by effective concentration of the drug into the vehicle. Just by increasing the concentration of the drug into the your base, we can increase the penetration. Also, by improving the partitioning of your drug in the both phases, also we can increase the penetration of your drug. Sometimes we can decrease the thickness of the skin also. We can increase the penetration of your drug. Then which kind of penetrating enhancers we can use into the your ointments? So there are the different types of penetrating enhancer are there, like surface acting agents. Examples are sodium lauryl sulfate, then sodium laurate, then T180 polysorbate. Then another examples of surface act your penetrating enhancers are like bile salts derivatives are there, like sodium glycolate, sodium dexacolate. Then another are fatty acid type of penetrating enhancer are there, like oleic acid, then caprylic acid, then chelating agents like EDTA, citric acid. So these are the penetrating enhancer agents we can added into the your drugs ointments. Then polyols type of their monohydric alcohols, miscellaneous type of like urea, terpenes, then phospholipids, water is also there. Now, ideal properties of penetrating enhancers. If you are going to add the penetrating enhancing agents into your semi-solid dosage form, then what kind of ideal property should be to the your penetrating enhancers? So your penetrating enhancer must be a non-toxic in nature, non-irritating in nature, then non-allergic in nature. Then it should be work rapidly. It should penetrate your drug very fastly. Then it should be not having the any kind of pharmacological action. Then it should work unidirectionally, means only at one directional your drug should be passed into the your skin. Then it should have the, you can say, cosmetically acceptable one. Your penetration enhancer should not have any kind of typical color. Then it should be compatible with the other excipients. Sometimes we may use the heat as a penetration enhancer. So after the application of ointment, suppose you are just gently heating to the your affected part or applied part, then what will happen? Your penetration of the drug also can be increased, because after the application of the heat, what happens? Your drug will try to melt and it will transmit immediately from the your base into the your skin, because all the bases are made up of the waxing material. Suppose you are gently heating your affected part or just warming, okay, then what will happen? Your bases will get melt, and because of the meltation of the your bases, your drug will try to release from the base and it will penetrate to the your skin. Then ionotophoresis is the another mechanism is there. In the ionotophoresis, generally we are using the electric current to promote the flow of drug from one side of the skin to the blood flow, blood level. So here just we have to apply the your cream or the ointment or the paste or the your gel on the one part of the your skin, and from the downside of that hand, suppose at the upper side of the hand we have applied the cream, then on the downside we have to apply the your ionotophoresis mechanism. Suppose downside you have attached the electrodes and you have run this equipment, what will happen? It will generate the your electric type of field inside the, your that particular area of the hand, and because of the generation of the that mechanism, that electric charge, your molecules of the drug, they will try to travel another side of your hand, and hence from the upper layer of your skin they will go inside the blood. This is called as the ionotophoresis. See here, suppose you have applied here your skin, your material or your any kind of semi-solid dosage form, and another side suppose you have applied this instrument. So this instrument will develop the such kind of electric field, and because of that, whatever the drug molecules are present in the your semi-solid dosage form, they will try to attract it at the your instrument where we have applied it on other side. Generally there will be the positive and negative charges, and whatever the drug molecule is there, they will have the already positive charge. If in the instrument you have developed the negative charge, then that positively charged particles will try to move toward the your instrument, and by this way from the skin they will try to travel toward the your instrument, and they will try to pass into the your blood. As soon as they will pass into the blood, they will be taken by the your blood. So just to attract the your drug particles, we have to apply this ionotophoresis mechanism. So this is the little bit modified mechanism by which we can increase the penetration rate of your drug through the semi-solid dosage form. Then another technology is there, that is called as the wireless patch. Nowadays wireless patch are also developed to increase the penetration of your drug. Then we can use the ultrasound mechanism also. By after the application of your medicament on the surface of the skin, from the another side we can develop the ultrasound, and because of that ultrasound your drug will try to dissolve and it will try to absorb inside your blood. See, these are the ultrasound penetration enhancers. So there will be the instrument. After the application of your medicament, from the upper side we have to apply the your ultrasound instrument. Then microneedle penetration enhancer is there. Now micro needle means there are the different types of needles are available on the one flat surface. So prior to application or before application, just puncture the your skin with the help of these micro needles. These micro needles will puncture the your skin, but though no blood will come out. Okay, only the they will puncture the your skin and they will make the channels, and after that we have to remove that patch. So because of the puncturing, there will be the various channels will be developed or the holes will be developed on your skin, and after that we can apply the your ointments. Now after the application, what will happen? Already your skin is punctured, different number of the holes will be present, and because of the that holes, your applied ointment will easily penetrate your drug through that punctured area and it will reach to the your blood. The micron size of that puncture or that holes will be the in 200 micron to 750 micron size. See, such kind of punctures will be there on the your skin. There will be the no pain or no bleeding, only minute punctures are there. Nowadays this is the, we can say, modern type of we can say tool is utilized to enhance the penetration of the medicaments inside your skin. Then hollow micro needles are also there. In this technology, first of all you just apply these needles on your skin, and then after that you apply the your medicament on the your needles, and through that needles your drug will pass inside the your skin. As you are injecting your solution into the your muscles, so in the same way we are injecting your drug or the your ointment through the your micro needles. So these needles are also very small in size. Once we have punctured inside the skin, just apply the your medicament, and through that needle your ointment will be passed inside your skin at the deeper layer. See, this is the, we can say, micro needles. There is the one company that is called as the Intanza, and they have developed their vaccine, and through this needle they are releasing the your material inside your skin layer, not into the blood. So this is about your